watched you walk in, but you're not the life of the party. I'll bet you leave early. You don't take the lead, you always take the back seat. You're always on the offbeat. Well, I dare you to get out there and lay it on the line. From zero to hero, now's your time to shine. 'Cause I believe in you. I will see you through. Tonight's the night to come out of the shell. Step up, explode, let me hear you yell. 'Cause I believe in you.
Welcome, everybody. This is Richard Sachs. Happy New Year, and we're getting ready for a really incredible discussion right now with our next January show for starting out this new year in a very interesting and exciting way. And we were, I've wanted to get this man, Dr. Stephen Greer, on the radio on our show for a long time. He's really hard to reach, and I'm down to having to send him snail mail invitations now, and I hope he accepts. But in the meantime, he's done a just amazing video and audio presentation of his work recently in, I think it was in Virginia. And I decided we ought to play that in a couple of different parts on the show, because Dr. Stephen Greer is a really amazing and unique researcher, and I appreciate real research being involved in that myself in the health field and connected fields to that. So who he is, he's an emergency room doctor, and he just worked as a medical doctor for many years. And starting very early in his life, he had an experience of contact with UFO and ET intelligence. And if you feel like that's, something outside of the realm of your interest, or it's just, by definition not possible or untrue, I totally respect that. Whatever you believe, I think your main focus is to be true to yourself. But for those of us who are open to this, and I certainly am, I've had some complimentary experiences to this myself and continue to have those pretty much on a daily basis at this point. And I know a lot of you are saying, oh, I knew this guy was crazy, you have to never listen to that show again. That's fine, because I have an obligation to really be honest and tell the truth here, and this show is for those that are interested along these lines. And remember that any idea is not really a threat to you, because it's either going to become obviously true or obviously untrue. And real science, by the way, is not ruling out anything until you really look at it and evaluate it. And that is basically honesty. And it's been lost in modern science. So I would encourage you to try to adopt some of the principles of real science, because a long time ago it was practiced by some people who made great discoveries, and we still have the same opportunity that they did in every part of our life. So in this particular area where we're looking at the possible interaction with intelligent life from places other than our particular planet, which is an infinitesimally small piece of even this particular physical universe, and there are very likely realities not limited to this physical universe, and there may be more than one physical universe. It's a huge place. Even in our galaxy, there are so many different systems and worlds that can be inhabited, and just because the inhabitants don't look like what we think of as regular humans means really virtually nothing, because to think that our life form is the only one, or the only good one, or the only legitimate one That's basically out of fear of finding out something we don't want to know about in the unknown. And so for this presentation, I would really encourage you to drop any trace of fear and just be interested and open. One of the reasons that I wanted you to hear this talk by Dr. Greer is that he's not solely focused on communication with UFOs. The process of him getting the information is incredibly fascinating, because he didn't do it by just going out and finding groups that said, oh yeah, I saw a UFO and I talked to 10 beings inside a UFO and I promise I really did. I mean, he didn't do that. He was a doctor. He was trained in being very meticulous in investigation and observation of data. So he went to people inside government at very high levels, as you'll see, way higher than the levels that we're normally aware of, above, way above president, above joint chiefs of staff, and people that were in non-disclosed projects within government. And basically, they had to risk their lives to talk to him. These are not flakes. They're really not flakes. He talked to thousands of them and correlated all of their evidence, video recorded a lot of it. I mean, he's just got an incredible library now of testimony from people that were inside these highly classified positions, and there are verified thousands and thousands of not just sightings of UFOs. And UFO, by the way, does not mean little green men. It means unidentified flying object. So anything that the ground radar, the regular agencies don't know about and don't know who it is and can't find out, those are UFOs until otherwise classified. And so not only were there people willing to come out and testify about the sightings and pilots, you know, seeing things flying right next to their plane, doing impossible maneuvers, things like this, and that's not just a few people, and it's very solid individuals. They also had direct sightings of many instances where these craft were shot down by advanced weapons of of the U.S. government, military, or others. And there were beings inside some of them. This is just what happened. I mean, I'm sorry if it's uncomfortable to believe in or goes against some other belief. You don't have to believe anything, but this is what many, many witnesses can testify to, and they're not making it up. So this is the material that we're looking at. And in the course of taking this testimony, Dr. Greer found out about all kinds of detail on how the secret aspects of the federal government operate. And I find that incredibly useful and interesting. Good for remember, we're going to start educating ourselves. And since regular school's not going to do it for you, the media is going to teach you things that aren't true to manipulate your belief system. And you are totally responsible for educating yourself. No matter what anyone says, no matter what any belief system tells you, you don't know it until you verify it internally in yourself. And so that's what I'm inviting you to do. And what we're sharing here is an incredible resource. Stephen Greer is an amazingly courageous individual. He knows that he could be killed at any moment for what he's doing. He's had very serious high-level death threats. He televises and live streams everything that he's doing so that he can't easily be secretly murdered, but he knows it could happen anyway. But at this point, he's so high profile that killing him would just put an exclamation on everything that he's found to be true, similar to Alex Jones, who's done amazingly inspiring work and continues to be a news source worth listening to as often as you can. PrisonPlanet.tv, pay the $6 a month, hear the real news while it's still there. It could disappear any day. And for written version, go to Infowars.com. I am not being paid or requested to say that. That's because I think they're doing an incredible job and need support. Anyway, I've got a few points to get through, and we only have a couple more minutes before we have to start this presentation. It's not a discussion this time like it usually is with me. It's a presentation by Dr. Greer, and you're going to hear the whole first half today and the second half next week, God willing. And I hope you get a lot out of it to think about. You don't have to agree. I don't want you to agree with anything just to agree with it. You know, just take it like a real scientist would, if there were any of those around still, and investigate, you know, inside and outside of yourself. Anyway, this project about the UFO information, as you'll hear in the presentation, was classified above the classification of the hydrogen bomb project in the 50s. The hydrogen bomb project being not the atomic bomb that was dropped on Japan twice, but the hydrogen bomb, which is even worse, and it's it had very high classification. The UFO project is way above that in secrecy. And the problem that Dr. Greer comes to, as you'll hear, is that technology way, way above what we're told about is in the wrong hands. And I found it also interesting, and I've been talking about that for a long time, but I found it interesting that he confirms, as I've often said, we have not needed the oil-based energy system since the early 1900s. And this thing that it would take a long time to roll out alternative technology, completely not true. And he tells you why. Because it's real simple. You know, tabletop devices can power your home, and you can carry them around smaller than a briefcase. I mean, that's known, and it's in operation now. None of these things are for you to find out about. Okay, so he talks about Operation Paperclip, bringing over the Nazi scientists that were learning about things like how to control gravity, which they were just about done with and has been finished since then. So there is complete technology to neutralize gravity now in use, flying around on these old jets in the sky, on technology that is many decades old. That's to keep the public totally in the dark and to use the oil industry as an excuse for the endless war that makes people, you know, super rich and powerful. And, you know, I have to mention something else. We're just about out of time here. I got to go faster. Dr. Greer mentions now that he quit working as a regular doctor, saving one person at a time in emergency rooms. And I am in total awe and respect of doctors, medical doctors who save people in emergency rooms and do reconstructive surgery after accidents and stuff. That stuff is fantastic. What I take exception to in the medical industry is what they have to say and do about disease. That's a long story. You know how I feel about it. But he said now he's dropped that and he's working to save Gaia, the Earth, and her 7 billion children. Don't write that off because the UN is using the Gaia nonsense to enslave humanity, which they absolutely are. You have to get a little bit more subtle and alert to these things. Gaia, like so many other things, has reality. You know, everything, including the Earth, has consciousness all through it because of who created it and where it came from. There is no inanimate planet that we're living on. It's not how it is. And she is aware. The indigenous tribes, you know, all over the world have known this and are far more advanced than so-called modern science that thinks everything's a pile of rock. And atoms just happen to line up by chance to make us alive and create consciousness. That's not how it worked. And a lot of people have found that out. So be open, be like a real scientist and just consider everything and question everything. And don't just accept things without really investigating. The other thing is that I've said many times that Einstein mentioned that a little bit particle of matter has enough energy in it to recreate the whole universe. Dr. Greer says that in another way, that one cubic centimeter of space could provide enough power for the U.S. for a year. And I think That's really conservative. Actually, it has much more than that. So these technologies that are real and already known, they would not take too long to roll out. What's preventing that is that the archaic energy industry and transportation industry, all these things, they're giving an elite class of people at near the top of the power structure, not at it, but near it, the ability to live like super monarchs and queens and kings. And they're just willing to kill anybody who gets in the way of that. So this is a big problem I haven't heard anybody come up with a solution for. So pay attention to Dr. Greer's work, and I'll come back and talk to you after the first half of his presentation, which we'll go to now.
Okay, I would like to welcome all of you to this special presentation on the deep national security state and UFOs. And this is going to be a presentation 4 hours in length. We will take a break at about the halfway point, maybe about 1 hour and 45 minutes in, 2 hours. And I'd like to just thank all of you for coming. I know you've been from all over the country here, people here from Chicago, New York, all over, and I want to express my appreciation for your support and effort in coming all that way to be here. I'd also like to welcome all the folks online. There are several thousand people online who will be seeing this by webinar, and I'd like to extend a welcome to them and a big shout out to them for coming. Thank you. You're here in virtual reality, huh? Yeah, why not? So I'm Dr. Stephen Greer, and the founder of the Disclosure Project and the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence and the Orion Project. Those are all now sort of amalgamated under seriousdisclosure.com if you want to go and see what all the projects are doing at any time. And we're going to be doing this presentation, which is going to be part of a series. I really want to thank the people who've supported me all these years in getting this far. There's some folks who are volunteers out front who've been on many expeditions with me out under the stars, and people all over the world. My mentors in the national security state, who without them I would have never had a Sherpa to figure out how this whole system works. You're going to learn things tonight, today, that the President of the United States doesn't know. I will assure you of that. I will give you my assurance that it's true. It is also true that without some very special person, and her name is Emily, my wife of 36 years, we wouldn't be here. So a big thank you to Emily. She set this up. And really and truly, if Emily had not supported me all these years, there aren't many Jewish doctors, daughters, wives, who will be happy with their husband leaving a career in emergency medicine to be doing this for virtually nothing for 25 years. And that's when we started this project 25 years ago. So she's an amazing person, and without her, we would have never, ever gotten this far. She's really been the indispensable person that nobody knows about. I want to acknowledge her. So thank you, Emily. Love you. So the other thing I'd like to do, as we just some housekeeping things, again, no cell phones, please. And if there are any children who are on the webinar, I know this sounds strange. We're going to go through some things that are disturbing, and I would say parental discretion is advised for that reason. I usually would not say that, but we are today, and I need to say it. And the first thing I want to go through is sort of an architecture of what the deep national security state is. Because this is something that when I started out in 1990, I didn't think could possibly be true. And in fact, when I was meeting with the French government officials a few years ago here in Washington and then out at our farm in Virginia, I got a phone call from an Air Force intelligence guy and a liaison to the French president at that time, Nicolas Sarkozy, who said, "This is fantastic and terrible." And he didn't know if he quite believed it. And I said, "Well, come to Washington and I'll let you meet with some folks who are in the deep national security state who will confirm everything I'm about to tell you." So they came to Washington. And we had a meeting. And I began to explain to them that there are two governments. There's the government of we the people that Thomas Jefferson spoke of, that we have elected and those who have been appointed. And since World War II, there has evolved a monster, which we're going to hear about, which desperately needs to be put on a leash and eventually phased out. And that is the deep national security state of unacknowledged special access projects. Now, this is a term most people are not familiar with. Almost most of you, if you're anyone here from D.C., raise your hand if you're a D.C. person. You probably have heard of TSSCI, Top Secret Special Compartmented Intelligence. A top secret clearance are like 985,000 people who have them. It's, you know, that and $1.50 will get you on the metro. So those are not unusual. What's unusual are the projects I'm about to talk to you about. And these unacknowledged special access projects are projects that have not been supervised by the president or the Congress in an appropriate way since 1956, at least 1956. And this is a key date for you to keep in mind. I was 1 year old, so I couldn't do anything about that. Most of us here weren't of an age where we could have done anything about that disaster. But we're going to talk about how that evolved and how an unacknowledged special access project really operates. The very first thing you need to understand is that it developed as a consequence of the extraordinary secrecy around the UFO issue. And if you doubt it, it goes all the way back to 1945. And I'm going to go through some documents. The one that's up here is one that we acquired and released. It's now the number one viewed document on the FBI site, this one. But before I get to that, I want to talk about what happened in the 1940s, in World War II. So most of you know we had President Franklin Delano Roosevelt, and there were events going on in Europe and also in the Pacific, but mainly in Europe, where there were these things called Foo Fighters. Yes, it's a rock group. And Dave Grohl, it's a great guy, he named his band after what I'm about to tell you. But a Foo Fighter, aside from being a really fun rock band, were objects that were flying around our aircraft in World War II. Sometimes they were fully materialized, hard. Most of the time, they were an energy field that looked spherical. And they could come through an aircraft, even coming down the center of an aircraft and out the other end. This is the trans-dimensional nature of extraterrestrial technologies that I covered in a previous workshop. This became a huge concern for the Allies. And the Allies dispatched, or the president, I should say, on behalf of the Allies, dispatched a man named General Jimmy Doolittle. Now, how do I know this? Because his nephew is a dear friend of mine, Dr. John Altshuler. Dr. Altshuler is a hematologist-oncologist in Denver, very renowned. And he was asked, General Doolittle was asked to go over to the theater of operations in Europe to find out what the hell these things were. Now, the word Foo Fighters come from sort of French and German faux for fire, because they were these fiery, had a luminous corona around them. And but they would disrupt electromagnetic signals. They would have effects on the gravity around an aircraft and other things such as guidance systems, compasses, and what have you. And so we thought, the Americans and British thought, it was a secret Nazi weapon. And we found out through our spies that the Germans thought it was a secret Allied weapon. And of course, it was neither. So General Doolittle went over and investigated this and came back to the White House and reported back to President Roosevelt and said, "Sir, these are interplanetary vehicles," I'm quoting. And so began the modern era of a serious concern from the national security level about UFOs. You can argue it went back to the airship scare of late 1890s, where there were massive crafts seen off the coast of California, but there wasn't that much official concern at that point. It was sort of an enigma. But in World War II, because of the type of weapons being developed, both by Hitler and by America, the interstellars, as I call them, became very concerned about what humans were doing on Earth and the risk of us destroying this planet, which I believe, in carefully in analyzing the history of this, that they have a interest in its survival and humanity's survival. And so the president at that point did assemble a group of folks that included Oppenheimer, people who worked on the Manhattan Project, Dr. Vannevar Bush, no relationship to President Bush, and others to look into the issue. By the time we detonated the first atomic bomb, the facilities at White Sands Missile Range in New Mexico, and Alamogordo, that area, were being overflown regularly by UFOs. And they were very concerned, obviously, that we were developing weapons that could terminate life on the planet. And they could see where this was headed. So this was not something that just happened out of the blue. There's a history here you must understand. In the early days, and I'm talking now from the early mid-1940s until 1956, there was a reasonable level of constitutional oversight by key members of Congress, senior people in the administrations, and the President of the United States. Everything changed in 1956. Now, when we had the only nuclear, and it actually technically it's an atomic bomb squadron and not a thermonuclear one that was developed later. Everybody know the difference between atomic and thermonuclear? Atomic bomb is fission, nuclear is fusion, hydrogen. Anyway, the atomic bomb that we dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki was developed, as you all know, in New Mexico, and was tested at White Sands, and eventually in Roswell, New Mexico, that was the only bomber squadron that had atomic bombs in the world for a number of years before the Soviet Union developed them. And in 1947, there were two or three, I have intelligence recently that indicates there were three so-called flying saucers, discs, flying by and doing surveillance of the 509th Bomber Squadron, which was the only atomic bomb squadron in the world. And they switched on suddenly an alleged radar system. Read this document carefully. Now, this, I know it's hard for you to see the original. It's dated 1950. It was to J. Edgar Hoover. J. Edgar Hoover building's right near here. And an Air Force source stated that there were three flying saucers recovered in New Mexico. They're described as circular in shape with raised centers, 50 feet in diameter. Each one was occupied by three bodies of human shape, but only 3 feet tall. They're actually about 39 inches tall. In metallic cloth, very fine texture, etc. And it says that the saucers were found in New Mexico due to the fact that the government has a very high-powered radar set up in that area, and it's believed the radar interferes with the controlling mechanism of the saucers. This is a little bit anthropocentric and childish, because if you can go interstellar, you can handle a radar system. What actually happened is that those radar domes had a scalar longitudinal electromagnetic weapon, which is another whole classification of electromagnetic warfare systems that we'll get into later. But suffice it to say, it was an early scalar Star Wars hit. And when they switched that on, at least two of these discs collided. One went down northwest of Roswell. The other one continued and was more intact and was impacted near Socorro, New Mexico. And that's where they actually retrieved the bodies. The ones that was just north of Roswell was obliterated into little teeny pieces, tiny little pieces. Where they did retrieve, and we have Disclosure Project witnesses who have testified to this, where they who have personally seen what looks like almost hieroglyphic writing on some of the little parts that were retrieved, and I've seen these, and it's very interesting because it's reminiscent of the ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics, but not quite the same. Makes you wonder where the pyramids came from. So that event was an early hit. Now, there are some reports of others, but that's the most documented one. This document from the FBI is significant because, obviously, 3 years later, you had one branch of the government trying to find out what the other top-secret branch of the government was doing. You can tell by the tone of it. I made inquiries through here and there. So it's a bunch of skullduggery that happens between agencies and competition. And there's always been competition between FBI, CIA, Air Force Intelligence, et cetera, and so on. And this happens not just with the United States. It also happens between allies and alliances. For example, the next document, if you can pull this up, this is one of the most important documents. And by the way, after I briefed the CIA director about all this stuff, the sitting CIA director for President Clinton, which we'll get into in a moment, I got a cache of several thousand of these documents, about 5,000 of them. And they're in my vault. I don't know what to do with them. If we presented what was in them, it would take us from now until 2017. But let me just say that this document was accidentally released by the Canadian government, and if you look at the date on it, 1950, November 21st. How ironic. This is the 65th anniversary of the writing of this document by Wilbur Smith, who had a top secret clearance, and he was tasked by the Canadian government to find out what the Americans were doing. And if you look at page 2, if you go down to page 2 of this, you're going to see just a brief summary, which I think is, there's a whole lot of detail in the document. This is on our website now, you can look it up. Many of you may have seen this one already, but the reason I want to present it is the importance of the document. And it says, the matter is the most highly classified subject in the United States government, rating higher than the H-bomb. Think about that. The H-bomb wasn't detonated until 1952. It was the ultimate doomsday weapon. This project dealing with UFOs and interstellar technologies was more highly classified than the H-bomb. Period. B. Flying saucers exist. Period. Their modus operandi is unknown, but a concentrated effort is being made by a small group of headed by Dr. Vannevar Bush, who also worked with Edward Teller, Oppenheimer, and others. And 4, the entire matter is considered by the United States authorities to be of tremendous significance. I have a whole dossier that a Canadian put together of the Wilbur Smith investigations on behalf of the Canadian government to find out what in the hell the Americans were doing with these extraterrestrial vehicles. It's a fascinating case. Now, the reason this is so important is that it acknowledges several things, that they exist, that it's the most secret issue in the U.S. government, exceeding the secrecy of the H-bomb, and that a group had been put together to study how they operate. Well, they were studying materiel recovered from one or more interstellar crashes that were the result of using the scalar longitudinal electromagnetic systems, which Tesla had worked on and others had worked on in the early part of the 20th century. Keep in mind that by the early 1900s, there had been experiments done on not only scalar and electromagnetics, that longitudinal systems, which are, just to put it in a simple layman's term, the light in this room that we're looking at, it has a wave function and a particle function. It goes 186,000 miles a second. A scalar longitudinal system is there's no wave. It's boom, and it's a point, and it's multiples of the speed of light. And so once you understand how these operate, and I have folks at the Naval Research Labs here in Washington who have done communication systems developed based on pulsed scalar systems that are multiple of the speed of light. So if you think that you cannot communicate faster than the speed of light, you are wrong. And the physicists are wrong. It's because they don't know about the scalar end of this, but that's enough because that's all classified. They're not going to teach you that at MIT or Caltech. So these systems have been developed and have been deployed since at least the mid-1940s, which is a frightening thought because it's an area of technology that is potentially devastating if it's in the wrong hands. And unfortunately, it fell into the wrong hands, and there it remains. So one of the things that happened along the lines around this time, the next document, a very important one. Look at the release date. It was a few months after I briefed the CIA director. So after I met with him, I said, look, I'm going to give you a list of stuff I want to see if I can get. I got this massive box. Came out to my farm in Virginia. And this is one of them, and there are others. And it's from 1953, although you can't see the date on it very well here. And it's written by the director of the CIA to the director of Psychological Strategy Board. Psychological Strategy Board. What? Psychological warfare. And it says, you can read it, I'm transmitting to the National Security Council a proposal, tab BA, which we don't have, which is concluded that the problems connected to UFOs appear to have implications for psychological warfare as well as for intelligence and operations. And then there's another tab B, which has the background. I'd love to see that one. I suggest that we discuss in an early board meeting the possible offensive or defensive utilization of these phenomena for psychological warfare purposes. Remember this document 4 hours from now. Because basically what they concluded was they needed to do a few things. They wanted to be able to set up a deception around the subject and put out false information, use it as a cover story for classified aerospace research. So oftentimes there will be something that happens and it will look like a UFO, and it's actually a Northrop Grumman. My uncle's company was Northrop Grumman. He worked on the thing that landed on the moon, the lunar module. Or Lockheed Martin Skunk Works or some other aerospace entity, and it will be 100% man-made, and the public will say, oh my God, it's a UFO. And they'll not correct them. There's no correction forthcoming. They want you to believe it's a UFO. Why? Because it provides a cover for classified research with technologies that, if they were allowed to come out, would terminate the oil and gas and coal industry. They're using zero-point energy and gravity control. Which then brings me to the next issue. And that is, by 1954, October, so now we're 61 years plus 1 month, into an era, and this was confirmed to me by the third highest ranking official at the Naval Research Labs and the highest ranking scientist, in other words, someone who wasn't a bureaucrat, at the Naval Research Labs, which Thomas Edison founded, and the Naval Research Labs is the largest defense lab in the United States. And Richard Foch, and I knew him for many years before he passed away of prostate cancer not too long ago, was this gentleman. I've never wanted to discuss who he was until he passed away. And he was a very senior guy in this system. And one of the things that he shared is that he was in the vault, the same vault that the next document came out of, which has a great story behind it. And he was going through some documentation and found that it wasn't in the 50s that we really started, I mean the 60s or 70s, but it was in the 50s that we actually mastered gravity control. Now what does that mean? Gravity control is the ability to put an electromagnetic field at certain voltages and with certain angular momentum. I don't want to get into a lot of, put you to sleep, I got into the physics of it too far, so that this object becomes massless, weightless, no mass, M-A-S-S. So the mass component, and this has to do with angular momentum and things of this sort, of the subatomic particles, can make this object so light that it has no mass, which means if you look at your physics equations, mass, velocity is inversely proportional to mass. Go look it up. So if mass becomes zero, velocity can go to infinity in a given amount of energy, which means you can move into another dimension. It doesn't go to infinity. You go trans-dimensional. We'll talk about this some more later. And this began to be experimented with in the 1920s. A guy named T. Townsend Brown developed a system using crystalline structures and very high voltages going into an object so that an object would begin to levitate. Marcel Vogel, one of the chief engineer scientists for IBM in North Carolina on the Reynolds estate, did the same thing in the 60s and 70s. One of the members of my team and one of our disclosure project witnesses worked with Marcel Vogel doing this with crystalline structures. And it can be crystals, but it can also be nanocrystalline materials such as metallic. So, as you know, most metals and rocks are crystal. Actually, water is crystalline. We're crystalline. So you can put this system around almost anything, and it will begin to become increasingly massless. Now, it doesn't have to be zero mass. Maybe it's 0.1 mass. So it's still materialized, and you see it. But it means, man, can you accelerate this thing? So it means you can, instead of going like the space shuttle at 25,000 miles an hour, you can go at several million miles per hour and take a right turn. And there's no deceleration effect because everyone on board is corrected for 1G. So this is what they began, 1G gravitational force. So this is what began to develop in the 20s, got taken into some Army Air Force projects in the 30s and 40s, and was Adolf Hitler's secret weapon. Adolf Hitler, they weren't making the progress on the atomic bomb that we were, but they had almost perfected gravity control by the time World War II ended. Now, one of the things that the OSS did, the Office of the Special Services, which became the CIA after World War II, they had something, you can look this up, called Operation Paperclip. And Operation Paperclip, a whole book was written on it not too long ago, about how they would put a paperclip on the file of the Nazis that we didn't want to go to Nuremberg and execute, but that whose knowledge was so great that we wanted them as part of our program. We wanted what they knew. So one of these guys is a guy named Werner von Braun, who, of course, invented the rocket, the V-2 rocket for Adolf Hitler. Hermann Oberth. These were all the giants of rocketry and aerospace for Adolf Hitler. They became the foundation of, brought in by the CIA, what became the CIA, of our space program in the 1940s and 50s, which is how we leapt ahead of the Soviet Union, because we took all those people first, ahead of the Soviet Union. Interesting bit of history. You don't read this many places. But a lot of what I'm telling you is in conventional history books, not the UFO part. That's been sanitized out. That's forbidden knowledge. So as a result, by the time we had those guys and the experimentation that had been done by T. Townsend Brown, whose work became a part of a corporation called the RAND Corporation, which still exists, a huge think tank, we really had something going. You add to this the study of materiel and electronics retrieved from interstellar vehicles that were shot down. So a lot of people say, oh, well, the things we have, are they all just reverse engineered from interstellar ET? I said, no. The laws of the universe are universal, and the mind of man, just like the man of an ET, can unravel the mysteries of the universe. And so it has come to pass. But if you take, we're not starting at zero when we retrieve the objects that were interstellar. We were starting with decades of research in classified electronics, electromagnetic fields, anti-gravity, scalar systems, et cetera, and so on, that had been going on since the time of Nikola Tesla, the true genius of the 20th century, not Albert Einstein, by the way, who is a minor luminary compared to Tesla. And, sorry, Einstein fans, it's true. By the way, that's why when Nikola Tesla died, the FBI swooped into his apartment and confiscated all of his secret papers. And how do I know this? I have a document from the Department of Defense demanding that the FBI turn them over and names them for what they are, the secret papers of Nikola Tesla. This is not an urban myth. I have that document. It came in this cache of documents I'm talking about. So when you have all of that knowledge, it's then augmented, increased, potentiated by the study of, as the Wilbur Smith document says, the materiel that was interstellar. Because you need specialized materials. You need control systems. You need integrated circuits, which we did not have in the 40s. Which came from this. You need fiber optics. You need all kinds of stuff. So some of the technologies, and this is where Colonel Corso, who worked on these projects tangentially, is correct. If you read The Day After Roswell, he says fiber optics, integrated circuits, and a whole slew of things came from studying the materiel from these crashed ET interstellar objects. So you had the biggest and most top secret, most well-funded project in the history of the United States going on. Nobody knew about it. It's completely sub rosa. It was more secret than the hydrogen bomb. And so between 1945 and 1954, the brain power of those Nazi aerospace folks like Wernher von Braun and Herbert Oberth, the work of T. Townsend Brown and others, Edward Teller, some of the brightest and most ingenious people in the world, bent their attention primarily not to the hydrogen bomb, but to gravity control and how are these interstellar visitors getting here. Because that would then be the ultimate edge, wouldn't it, in the technological arms race. You talk about a delivery system. You don't need an intercontinental ballistic missile that goes a few thousand miles an hour if you can deliver something instantly from one continent to another, or worse, from one planet to another. You begin to see the implications of this for national security. Therefore, it was managed in an extraordinary fashion, and the secrecy around it was increasingly ruthless. So much so that by 1956, the President of the United States, a man named Dwight Eisenhower, most of us drive on Eisenhower-era highways using 1880s Mercedes-type internal combustion engine cars that are run by fossil fuels, all of which have been obsolete since the 1940s or sooner. But Eisenhower was a five-star general, became president, two-term president, and was a Republican, very patriotic, but also very naively trusting. Jackie Gleason, the very famous comedian, his wife, were friends with some folks that had been on my team before they passed away, and said that Eisenhower on his deathbed was a very bitter man over what happened to him between 1954 and when he left office in early 1961, when Jack Kennedy became the President of the United States. And in 1956, a man named Nelson Rockefeller, who later, of course, became Vice President, and prior to that was an operative in the military-industrial complex and the emerging deep national security state, Nelson headed up what's called the Rockefeller Commission. And the Rockefeller Commission in 1956 reorganized the Pentagon, Department of Defense, CIA, the whole alphabet soup of secret entities. And they did so in such a way that it became labyrinthine, Byzantine, almost impossible to penetrate by anyone who wanted to navigate through it. In the early days, there was still some presidential knowledge. We have one of our witnesses, Mr. Lovkin, who is an attorney, who was a young man, White House Signal Corps here at the White House down the street from where we're speaking today. You can look at his testimony on our website, seriousdisclosure.com, and he said, yes, he would be at meetings and the Eisenhower would be making doodles, pictures of UFOs and ET craft. In fact, I have one sitting in my condo here in D.C. that someone lifted from the archives, I won't say where and how. And he said basically Eisenhower was voiced to him great frustration over the fact that there were all these projects going on and he had lost control of the oversight of them. So what happened with the Rockefeller Commission in 1956 is that they made it virtually impossible for any ordinary congressman or president, because you know they come every 4 to 8 years, don't they? So by the time they leave, even if they're there 8 years, maybe they're a little less wet behind the ears. But it's a system that guarantees their ignorance, except to the extent that they want to give you just enough information to control what's going on. We'll get into this in a moment. So by the time Eisenhower left office, he made the very famous speech about beware the military-industrial complex, as you've seen in the film Sirius. By the way, Sirius became number one on Netflix a few months ago. Cool. Thank you guys for supporting that. And the president said it will become a threat to our national security and our way of life, not the UFOs, the secrecy. No less a figure the same year, Admiral Roscoe Hillenkoetter, who was the first director of the CIA. Go look this document up. I mean, I have more documents than we have time for me to go through. And it's a letter where he's writing and saying that the secrecy around the UFO subject is a threat to our national security and to the United States. This is the first CIA director, because he also later found out he was being schmick-canned, pushed aside by these neo-fascists who had taken over the intelligence community, the aerospace community, and the large corporations. What happened over those years from 1947 until 1956 was that there was a deliberate, albeit imperceptible initially, takeover by the corporate state. Corporations working with unacknowledged special access projects, which are completely off the radar, not funded officially, took over operations. And as a result of that, those national security programs increasingly became out of reach for the president, out of reach for members of Congress, or even cabinet-level people like CIA directors and secretaries of state and secretaries of state and people of this sort. So this was a gradual thing that happened, but there was an abrupt change by 56. By 1961, when Eisenhower left office, frankly, we were done. It was done. Now, you know, I couldn't do anything about that at that point. Couldn't run the disclosure project because I was only 5 years old or six. And so it just suffered and went along. And the national security apparatus got bigger and bigger and bigger. When Jack Kennedy took over in January of 1961, he had a great interest in this. And he was, in fact, briefed on the subject But as we know from Lieutenant Halt, who was on the early meetings I had that ironically Nelson's brother Lawrence Rockefeller, who is the white hat in the Rockefeller clan, who actually wanted to end secrecy on the subject. Lawrence Rockefeller was a very early supporter of CSETI and the Disclosure Project. And he funded and I organized the Asilomar Monterey gathering of KGB, CIA, astronauts, cosmonauts in 1995. And what I found is that some of the people who came had been involved with the Kennedy administration. And one of these gentlemen, this lieutenant colonel, was on Air Force One flying to Berlin when Kennedy made that very famous speech, "I am a Berliner." Although I think he misspoke it a little. But from what I hear from the Germans. But on that flight, this Air Force officer, who was sort of like the chief steward who sort of ran Air Force One for the president, had a chat. And this issue came up because he had been a pilot who had seen one of these UFOs as an Air Force pilot. And there are thousands of sightings like this that we have in our archive. And he brought this up to the president. He says, "Oh, yes, I know about this." He says, "I've been briefed on it a little bit. But," and now I'm quoting, I have this audio tape. It is chilling, the audio tape. But he says, "Unfortunately, the whole matter," this is the president speaking, "the whole matter is out of my hands, and I don't know why." And began to cry. So we know, and that was 1963, June of 63. And of course, he was killed in November. But before that, some other tragic things happened. There are a lot of tragedies here. The main thing being the loss of almost a century of evolution by the human race, which is why I left medicine. I always tell people, I used to say, try to save a life one at a time. Now we have to do something to save the entire human race and planet from what is a disastrous situation that's developed. So I just say that now all of us have to work together because our patient is Gaia, the Earth, and her 7 billion children. But if you look at this document, the next one, this is a very dangerous document to have. I'm going to have to give you the provenance of this. This is the Marilyn Monroe document. It's basically a death warrant for poor Marilyn Monroe. And you look at the date on it, 3 August 1962. They found her dead the 5th of August. It's signed by James Jesus Angleton III at the bottom. Project Moondust up at the top, and Project 46. These are correct code names and code numbers for UFO ET-related projects by the agency as of that date. And as you read through it, and it gives some background, it's a wiretap summary if you look at the top of it. I know it's a very degraded document, but it's a wiretap summary of telephone conversations between Marilyn Monroe and Robert Kennedy, the Attorney General, and a guy named Rothberg, who was a art dealer in New York. And they were tapping Marilyn's phone because she had had tryst, as it says here, with the president. And everyone knows now she had an affair with both Jack Kennedy and Robert Kennedy. And in pillow talk, the president had told her some things. And it says one such secret that she was going to divulge in a news conference mentions the visit by the president at a secret airbase for the purpose of inspecting things from outer space. I don't think they're talking about meteorites. Kilgallen, who had been a reporter who dug into this, replied that she knew what might be the source of the visit. In the mid-50s, Kilgallen learned of a secret effort by U.S. and U.K. governments to identify the origins of crashed spacecraft and dead bodies from a British government official. That was Lord Mountbatten. Kilgallen believed the story, who was later blown up by an IRA bomb, or so it was made to appear. Kilgallen believed the story may have come from the New Mexico crash in the late 40s, clear reference to the Roswell event. And She said that if the story is true, it would cause terrible embarrassment to Jack and his plans to have NASA put men on the moon, because we were using old rockets from the 40s when the secret organization already had anti-gravity under control. The subject repeatedly called the attorney general and complained about the way she was being ignored by the president. The subject threatened to hold a press conference and would tell all, underline in the original document. That's not my underlining. The subject made references to bases in Cuba and knew of the president's plan to kill Castro. And number five, the subject made references to her diary of secrets and what the newspapers would do with such disclosures. 2 days later, she's found dead. Now, this document, how did I get it? It's top secret, and it has not been declassified, and it is authentic. A man whose family helped found the National Security Agency, NSA, was so supportive of what the work I was doing that he appeared one day with this document. And it was a huge, one of those old Xerox from a big, government Xerox machine. The original I have in my vault is quite impressive. And he says, you need to know the kinds of things. I think he was not trying to scare me off, but he was wanting me to know the kinds of things that have been done to people who tell these kind of secrets. And so he gave me this document. And as soon as I saw it, I suspected it was legitimate. Later, I had it inspected by a man who I don't wish to name, but he was the officer who was General Odom, O-D-O-M, who was head of the NSA for years. He was General Odom's right-hand guy, literally carried his briefcase. And he became a document authenticator and a lecturer at University of Maryland, who, frankly, when he looked at it, he says, without me taking it from the vault myself, I can tell you 95% certainty it's authentic, because everything in it. So basically what happened is that Marilyn Monroe was being jilted by the Kennedys because it was becoming too well known they were having an affair. The Kennedys did not order her assassination. Angleton did. Now, who is Angleton? Angleton was the big, whole books have been written about this guy. James Jesus Angleton III was the guy who at the CIA was the big mole hunter. He was the guy who would chase down anywhere a leak was coming from and had everyone tapped. And he realized that she was about to light this up and hold a press conference to talk about the ET bodies from outer space and all these secrets that Jack Kennedy had told her, just out of spite. She was just furious that they had sort of pushed her out of the inner circle. And, you know, the whole thing about a woman scorned. But unfortunately for Marilyn, it cost her life. I later, after I got this document, met with a man who at that time had worked in the intelligence unit of the Los Angeles Police Department, who separately had a wiretap on her in her home, who confirmed to me this was 100% true. Now, I don't know how many of you know a guy named Burl Ives, who's an actor and singer, and everyone thinks he was like Frosty the Snowman, but he was actually a very accomplished actor and folk singer, and very good friends with Marilyn Monroe, Elizabeth Taylor, people like that. And he was on my executive committee for a number of years, and by the time he was involved, I had that document. And I went to visit him. They had moved from Montecito in Santa Barbara up to Anacortes, Washington. And I was in his room. I was actually sitting on the edge of his bed. He was up there in years. Big, jolly guy. Great bear of a guy. And I shared this document with him. He says, oh, my God. He's a 33rd degree Mason, by the way. He says, we all know, every one of us knew Marilyn had been killed, but we never knew why. We had no idea why. This is why. This is the thing. And so that was also a shot across the bow to the Kennedys. Now, Jack Kennedy had great affection for Marilyn, even though it was indiscreet for him to continue seeing her. And he was furious that someone in the intelligence community, I don't even think he certainly didn't know about this document. He was very upset, is what I understand, that Marilyn was killed by these operatives. And he vowed to try to bring out this information himself. And I think that's why he began to speak a little more openly to this Air Force officer whose audio recording I have. And that was, of course, a year later. This happened in August of 62. The recording with the Air Force officer, that conversation with Jack Kennedy, happened in 1963, June. In November, he was assassinated. As Kennedy was planning, if he had become the president, he was going to dissolve the CIA, get us out of Vietnam, disclose this information, and make peace with the Soviet Union. That's what he was going to do. And those folks in the intelligence community and the warmongers and the profiteers and the military-industrial complex said, like bloody hell you will. And that was the end of him. So that's why, I mean, although I thought they were joking initially, when I first... Is this good information for you folks? I hope it's not too much, but I'm going to cover an enormous amount today. You've got to know the background. So over this time period from 1945, 40s to 19 early 60s, there developed, a decision was made. I know this sounds like a joke because everyone says it. If I tell you, I have to kill you. But there's some truth to that. So the secrecy that got developed around this issue became more and more and more restricted, even from people who were presidents or Senate Intelligence Committee members or members of the cabinet. Because another man who was killed was John Foster Dulles, shoved out of a window. Dulles was killed. He had been CIA director. He was starting to make noises about changing the direction of things, and he was also killed. Dulles Airport's named after him. So the decision was made, how do we do this without risking having to continue to engage in the wet works? And there's a guy I know at the CIA who kind of has my back, who has been there for years, PhD guy, who has a team of wet works guys. Wet works are assassinations. So wet works are, wet comes from blood. So, you know, you don't want to pull the trigger on wet works if you don't have to. So they've decided here in the 50s and 60s to create so much secrecy and have it so compartmentalized and tightly held that they didn't want to risk doing that anymore, because it was really disruptive to the nation. And that is really the genesis of unacknowledged special access projects. Now, a special access project just means you have to have the clearance to get to it and be read into it, as they say in military speak. But an unacknowledged project, I just want to go through a minute how that works. Let's say that this gentleman is a four-star general, and I'm a colonel. I made you a four-star general. But I'm in an unacknowledged special access project dealing with this or some other subject. It can be other things as well. If I am in an unacknowledged project, I am told, and I have one of my most senior military advisors has been in multiple of these. He was in one project that was $2 to $3 billion. He knew it was more than two and almost $3 billion in a project that was off the books, no accounting, president didn't know, Congress didn't know, tightly held, a military guy working with some corporate folks. And he told me, he says, here's how it works. He says, they take you to a SCIF, a Secure Communication Intelligence Facility, SCIF. Take all the equipment off of you, any guns off, cell phones, watches, nothing, anything metallic. You go into this underground facility, and there's a meeting. And he said, you have a come into Jesus talk. And what happens is that you are told that only the people in that room are read into and cleared to this unacknowledged special access project. And if you speak of it outside of that circle of people, there's one person there with a gun and a bullet. He takes the bullet out and he says, It has your name on it if you speak to anyone, and I mean anyone, your wife, the president, your commander, about what we're doing. And that is how it works. This is not a conspiracy theory. I've been in these skiffs. I've been in a couple places, and I can tell you that is exactly how it operates. So one of the things I wanted to make really clear about what I'm presenting today, I'm not talking about anything that I don't have firsthand direct knowledge of. Everything I'm telling you, every bit of it. But I don't care about conspiracy theories. They're mostly 99% wrong. And I really don't care about the internet chatter. You know, this is 25 years of the most incredible investigative research. And, you know, I put over $10 million of my earnings and life into doing to get this far. And I can tell you, if you're in an unacknowledged project, and I was offered this position back in 92, and asked my wife about it, and I rejected it. I was actually offered $2 billion personally. If a fund with $2 billion in it, if I would shut the hell up, join one of these unacknowledged projects and do what they wanted me to do. And I said, screw you. I'm not doing it. But that's what was offered. And that's when $1 billion was a lot of money back then. Now, you know, they're minting a billionaire every week in Silicon Valley. But, you know, in 1992, $2 billion was a lot of money. So what ended up happening in this scenario is that if my four-star commanding general calls me in because he's heard rumblings about something that people are working on he didn't know about, under threat of death, TWEEP, terminate with extreme prejudice, which is death, TWEP, I am to turn to him, even though he's my four-star commanding, I'm only a colonel, and I'm to say, sir, no such project exists. That's how it works. It's illegal. It's unconstitutional. It's criminal. It's dangerous. Because once you have a breakdown in the rule of law, we're back in the jungle. We're back into Al-Qaeda territory. We're back into the Wild West where there's a lawlessness. And that's what happened. And because of that, no president since Eisenhower has had anything near the level of information on this that would be required for the chief executive. Most CIA directors haven't. There are a few who have and a few who haven't. And I'll tell you a little bit about why that's the case in a moment. Who's been in and who's out? Dick Helms was in, Woolsey was out. It's a long story, but I mean, I'll try to cover it. I mean, you guys are going to get more information. It's going to be TMI, too much information by the end of this. But this is why I'm doing this today, is that I want to leave a record of everything I've learned that's critical for the public in case, you know, I'm 60 now. So who knows what will happen to me? So it's important to leave this. But if you're the president, don't assume that you have an all-access pass. The presidential daily briefing doesn't have anything really that critical in it. And almost never this subject. By the time you had Johnson come around, and then you had Nixon, and Nixon, by the way, was vice president for Eisenhower. Nixon actually was pulled in as head of the Space Committee. The vice president sits as chair of the Space Committee into Majestic. This group, MAJIC, M-A-J-I-C is actually what it's called. It's the Majority Intelligence Committee, M-A-J-I-C, it's the proper term. And MAJIC tapped Nixon, and he thought as president, he would be the guy that would disclose this. Because he thought it was time, and he was finally became president after Jack Kennedy, he felt, swindled him out of the presidency in 1960. And of course, Lyndon Johnson inherited the presidency, in a sense, after the assassination, had one term, part of another, the rest of Jack Kennedy's term. But Nixon thought, well, okay, I'm going to do this. And so a little thing called Watergate happened. Everybody remember Watergate? Those of you too young to remember, it was the break-in over here at this office in a luxury apartment on the Potomac. And it was a bag job. Bag men went in and broke into the Democratic National Committee offices to get lists and information, and Nixon ended up covering it up. I mean, it's kind of standard operating procedure. You know, it's like it wasn't really that big of a deal in the sense that it happens all the day. You just don't know it. But there was a guy named Woodard who was ONI. Office of Naval, you know, Bernstein, Woodard and Bernstein. Look it up. And Office of Naval Intelligence is where he came from. And suddenly this young reporter has this deep throat. Well, he had an ONI guy give him the information, Office of Naval Intelligence, because Nixon was planning to blow the lid off the secrecy. And the way they took him down was by impeachment rather than by a bullet. That's actually why Nixon was impeached. Now, he did do the Watergate, and he was a crook. But, I mean, I would say most politicians have engaged in such things. I know I'm a bit cynical about it, but, you know, it's not that unusual for dirty tricks and oppo research to be done against someone else, and you have someone go and steal something or rifle through trash to get dirt on someone, and that's what they were doing. And in this case, it was a break-in, so technically it was illegal, and then he covered it up, and he got impeached. But the real reason why that became such a big scandal and hit the shit hit the fan was that this ONI guy, Woodard, had a source that he worked who had the actionable intelligence on what really happened, and there goes the president. And of course, you know, we had Ford, who was a part-term time guy, and he had a CIA director, Bill Colby, who was a member of MAGIC. Bill Colby, I'm giving you like a 50-year history real quick. Is this good? You know, you need this, huh? Colby, and by the way, Nixon had a guy named Dick Helms who did not want me to talk about this at all and said as much to someone who is part of a group, and that woman is in this room today. But what ended up happening with Colby is that as he got older, he was very, very upset. And William Colby, CIA director, who was involved to an extent in the MAGIC operations, decided that it was really terrible what was happening to the country. And he's a very patriotic man. He was up there in years, and he decided to defect as a lone wolf, but an unacknowledged lone wolf. And this is why I'll never allow this again. So let me tell you what really happened to Bill Colby. Bill Colby, reached out to me through his best friend, a colonel who I will not name, is still living, and an elderly man, but a full bird colonel who had been in MAGIC, this committee that majority intelligence committee that oversees the UFO issue. And he wanted, Bill Colby wanted to bring forward the technologies, not the things that fly, but an energy technology based on these classified operations and some seed money, about $50 million in, I guess, kind of gray area seed money to my group so we could bring these technologies out and end the oil and global warming and the poverty and all of that. Now, the person who approached me, a member of my board, and this colonel, wouldn't say who the client was. They were going to set up a secret meeting. I said, I think it's safer if I know who he is. They said, why? I said, because I can put him into a security system. He says, what do you mean? I said, not knowing is dangerous for him. They said, no, he won't do it that way. So I said, okay. So I'm working full-time as a trauma doctor, emergency doctor, and we're setting that up. And the week before I'm going to meet with this former CIA director, they find him floating down the Potomac River, made to look like an accident, and he was assassinated. And it was tragic. And I said, I will never do this again. I felt terribly guilty. And his best friend came to my best friend's funeral, Sherry Adamack, who had been helping me for years and who was one of three of us who mysteriously got metastatic cancer the same month. Simeon, I think you knew Sherry, and this colonel came to her wake, and he just looked at me. He says, we can't look back. We have to keep putting one foot in front of the other, even though we both have had horrible losses. Yeah. So we did. We kept going. And, you know, when Bill Colby was killed, I thought at that point, well, his game is over. You know, I was, from 94 until now, I was about to give up on everything. But anyway, very, very difficult emotionally and very difficult physically to carry this for, you know, 25 years. But, you know, I figured this is the pearl of great price. You don't throw this one back in to the water. I mean, this is huge. So we decided we would just continue marshaling our energies and go forward. But we knew that we couldn't do anything like that again. It had to be open. I mean, I had to know, and to the extent things could, none of this skullduggery, because the secrecy is their domain. If you go to the National Reconnaissance Office, the super secret spy agency that runs all the satellites, above their entrance it says, "We own the night." You can look, Google it. And I always say, we need to own the light. We need to own the light of disclosure and the truth and bring this out. So I try to do things to the extent I can, fully as possible, out in the open, while maintaining the confidences of those who are still living who asked me to do so. But and that's why I'm giving you this much information today. The other thing to remember about how Colby's demise evolved was that he was going to make a run at one of the big central reasons for the secrecy, which I'll get into in a moment. And that's the technology. This is a big science and technology story. Because imagine bringing out a technology that would sit on this podium, that would run your house pulling energy from what's been called the zero-point energy field, that never has to be rebooted for, you know, fuel. It's pulling it out of the fabric of space-time. And it's estimated that every cubic centimeter of space in this room has enough energy to run the United States for a year, if you can tap it. And it has been tapped. So at the root of interstellar transport, aside from the transdimensional and anti-gravity, is the energy source. And the energy source is this amazing electromagnetic flux field. In fact, the early man-made UFOs were called flux liners because it's pulling energy out of this infinite ocean, this infinite sea, as Tesla called it. Professor Dirac called it the Dirac Sea, but it was this infinite field of energy that is at the root of space-time, embedded within space-time. And so bringing out something like that would, of course, immediately make oil, gas, coal, ExxonMobil, cars, internal combustion engines, jet engines, rockets, diesel, ocean liner engine, everything you can think of that we use would be obsolete and would be retired very quickly. Now, what I just named is several hundred trillion dollars in mineral assets and infrastructure, because we also wouldn't need a public utility. Every car and home would be self-sufficient unto itself. I mean, it is a whole new world. Now, we could have had that world before I was born. We don't have it yet. And as a result, we've decamped in the Middle East with our hegemony, and now we're facing World War III. So there are consequences to this kind of secrecy, unintended, and some are intended. But the unintended consequences are really about blowing back on us hard right now, both physically, geophysically, environmentally, geopolitically, and militarily. It's a very dangerous thing to thwart the development of normal technologies to be used for peaceful purposes. Now, that's the big caveat. Use them for peaceful purposes. Now, eventually, one of the things that happened along the lines of this was, how do we keep all this secret? Well, wet works kill people. Compartmentalization, unacknowledged special access projects, nobody outside the project knows. A big one is ridicule. I have a document from 1950s where they talk about engaging Disney Studios, which had done a lot of the OSS propaganda films in World War II. And Walt Disney was an asset of the CIA. And believe it or not, I mean, everyone thinks of cartoons, but so they were going to, they engaged Disney Studios to make Flying Saucer and Little Green Men films, you know, ha ha ha. And it ridiculed the subject so that respectable people would say, well, you're a kook if you're dealing with UFOs and ET issue. And that was done deliberately. And this was part of what I referred to in that earlier document, the psychological warfare value of the subject. How do you create the psychological nexus so that the subject becomes subject non grata? Like a person, persona non grata. It's a subject non grata. It's unwelcome. It has ridicule associated with it. And an Air Force major told me, who's one of our disclosure project witnesses, who was present when we shot and killed an ET on the tarmac at McGuire Field there in New Jersey. His testimony is quite riveting, if you've read the materials. And you know, he was saying, look, really the way this has been kept secret more than anything is just sheer ridicule. Nobody wants to be laughed at. Everyone's concerned what their friends might think. Because, you know, where's the tinfoil hat you're supposed to be wearing? So this ridicule got ramped up in 1953, in the psychological warfare programs. So by the time, you know, we came on the stage, we're 50, 60 years into a hole of ridicule and denial and countermeasures and everything else. That, how do you fix this? You know, it's very difficult because most reporters and media people don't want to be ridiculed, nor do scientific and people and professors and government folks. I mean, there's so many people in the Congress I've met with, very interested, know this is real. I'll say, will you hold a hearing on this? They go, oh, no, it'd be the end of my career. I'd be Labby the laughingstock. I'd be Senator Moonbeam or Congressman, you know, tinfoil hat or whatever. So that ridicule, which was ramped up in the 50s, has been very effective, incredibly effective. And that's one of the hard problems I've faced as well. Although, you know, as a medical doctor, luckily I was known as a very good emergency doctor before I got on Larry King Live and started doing stuff like this. But if it had been the other way around, I probably would have never been hired. Really. Yeah, so I was careful in my timing because I did have a family of four children to support. Luckily, they're all out of college now. So, now the next thing I want to, the next document, if you move on from Marilyn Monroe's tragedy, and it will be time at the end of today for you to ask questions. I'm sure your mind must be swirling by now about a lot of things. And this is the next document is the Peterson Memo, Arlington Institute. So this is the meeting that never happened with me and the CIA director. Very interesting. Look at the date. 3rd of December, 1993. The meeting between me and the sitting CIA director was the 13th of December, 1993. And is that document up? And the CIA director, R. James Woolsey, who, when information about my meeting came out after he had left office, denied it ever happened. Luckily, I could caught him in a flat-footed lie. I always tell people in Washington, how do you know these politicians and lawyers are lying? Their lips are moving. Their lips are moving, they're lying. I know it's a very cynical thing to say, but unfortunately very true. But this document, which I'm not going to go all the way through, but some of the information is very, very important. I talked to Woolsey this morning. He suggested getting together, underline. Project Starlight that's referred to here was the coalition I put together before the Disclosure Project, which no one knew about, where I was trying to get the president, President Clinton, to lead the disclosure on this. And it's a very interesting document because on the second page it says, remember, the most powerful people in the world will have a deep, compelling interest in our activities and will use everything in italics at their disposal to effect their objectives. Very threatening. And then he suggests that I get an encrypted portable phone because my kitchen doesn't have one. I mean, the whole thing is like such. Now, here I am. Of course, you know, I'm like 30-some years old. I'm an emergency doctor, and I'm being asked to come up and brief the sitting CIA director. Because, and if you read this carefully, it states in there, he's made inquiries and no one's telling him anything. This is a sitting director of the CIA. This is the proof the meeting took place. And there is other proof. Now, what the hell is going on that a sitting CIA director doesn't know anything about the most top secret CIA project? Illegal, outrageous, unconstitutional, criminal. And when I found this out, now remember, this is 22 years ago almost, it was a shock to me. Because I was raised like most people. I thought, you know, well, there's a president, there are all these spooks, and there's a chain of command, and it operates. I didn't know about unacknowledged special access projects. I certainly could not have imagined that the man who puts together the presidential daily briefing would be kept secret on stuff that I had collected unbelievable amounts of evidence for the existence of UFOs, extraterrestrial intelligence, et cetera, and so on. But that was the case. And when I met with this man for nearly 3 hours, it became quite clear to me that it was not a prevarication. I really thought that he was saying that just as a way of blowing me off, or, you know, not blowing me off, but sort of saying, you know, I want to meet with you to find out what you know, but I actually do know, and I'm going to pretend like I don't know. No, this man, and my wife can attest to this, was shaken to his foundation. The cover story for the meeting was a dinner party, and they're in the D.C. area, which is typical. The wives were invited as cover. Terrible thing to say, but it's true. So my wife was there. I was there. The CIA director and his wife, who's chief operating officer of the National Academy of Sciences, was there. And my host, John Peterson, and his wife. Interestingly, she didn't know who was coming to dinner until that afternoon. He wouldn't tell her. And then she finds out, like 2 hours before we appear, there's this UFO expert and the CIA director and his wife coming for dinner. Can you imagine being that wife? That was an I'm sure that night was an interesting conversation after we all left. But that's how these things are done. The real tragedy of it, though, is that if you have a breakdown in government this severe, those of you who are students of governance, where you can have a CIA director or senior members of the military who are being left out of something very important and which hundreds of billions of dollars per year are going into, then you have no government. So the deep national security state from 1950s until today has devolved into this sub rosa, unacknowledged, transnational entity with representation in the UK, Canada, Australia, Brazil, China, Russia, former Soviet Union, which on this issue work together like this. It is not responsive to the body politic. It is not responsive to the heads of government or even the heads of committees and cabinet level people. There are some cabinet level people, however, who have known. I mentioned a few. There was a CIA director known as George H.W. Bush, and the CIA headquarters is now named after him. He was a member and is a member of MAGIC. But then there are others, like Woolsey, who wouldn't be told anything. Some presidents have been given a little information, and some have been told nothing. Why? Well, here's how it works. It took me a long time to figure out something very simple. I call this a soul biopsy, because doctors are talking about biopsies, but it's a psychological analysis. So let's say this gentleman is the incoming director of the CIA. The outgoing director of the CIA is me. As incoming director of the CIA, they've taken your life apart and they know what your values are. If your values are that you would not go along with an illegal, criminal, unconstitutional effort, and engage in assassinations that were illegal and other things, they will never tell you about this. And even if you're the president that's incoming, this is what happened to Jimmy Carter. And I know this for a fact. Jimmy Carter got elected, and the outgoing CI director was, guess who? George H.W. Bush. George H.W. Bush, when he was called in and they had the transition meeting for between November and January, when they have the transition and they're standing up the new cabinet, was asked personally, face to face, by Jimmy Carter, and I met with someone who was there, about the UFO issue. And Bush said, "I'm not going to tell you," in a very derisive way, "about that. Go see if you can get it from the Congressional Research Service." Literally. Brushed him off. And Carter was stunned, because Carter had had a UFO sighting when he was governor of Georgia. I have his report form that he filed officially, signed Jimmy Carter. He ran in 1976 on ending UFO secrecy, actually. So he put together a White House study on UFOs, which we have Disclosure Project witnesses that attest there too, and they were reaching out to Stanford Research International to do SRI to do the study for them, because they couldn't get anything from outgoing CIA Director Bush. And that entity, SRI, had some people come in and threatened them and said, basically, if you want to receive any more contracts from the Department of Defense or the U.S. government, you will refuse to do this study for the White House. We have that as an affidavit signed from someone involved. So now, this is very extraordinary, but we have legal documents to prove it. So Carter was boxed out of this. And not long ago, he was at a signing ceremony, signing guitars in Spain to raise money for the Carter Center a few years ago. And a very well-known, I think his name's John Williams, well-known classical guitarist, who's on our team, was there and said, you know, at dinner, someone asked Carter, what was it like to be the most powerful man in the world? And President Carter said, I don't think I was that man. And everyone just thought he was joking. And he said, well, there are certain things I wasn't allowed to know about. And someone, very in a ridiculing way, said, ha, 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 what, like UFOs? And President Carter said, yes, that and more, referring to these energy and technology things. And so Carter wasn't joking. And it is true that he did not get access the whole time he was president, because he would have ended the secrecy and they knew it. It's also why he was a one-term president. Now, we had after him Ronald Reagan, or Ray Gunn, as I call him. R-A-Y. So a colonel who reached out to me was one of the guys who putting together the SDI, Strategic Defense Initiative, Star Wars. And he actually met with Carter and Reagan. Carter was a hard sell, Reagan was a soft sell on the billions to go into Star Wars. Now, the way it worked is that the Star Wars was always a cover story for targeting in space interstellar vehicles using these scalar weapons, not lasers. Not if it's at the speed of light, it's not fast enough. Everything important is faster than the speed of light. And so what happened is that he, at that point, got convinced. They sent just the right people in to convince Reagan that there was an existential alien threat. Basically what Wernher von Braun warned on his deathbed about, which we'll get to in a moment. And so Reagan bought into it. That's why you can Google this. At the UN, he said, wouldn't our job of uniting the world be easier if we could unite against a common alien threat? I'm paraphrasing, but you can look this up. Actually, Bill Clinton recently said that on Jimmy Kimmel, something very similar. The reason that happens is because there is a prevailing need for people who are in certain positions to be given what is I call targeted and tailor-made disinformation. information that is geared towards scaring the hell out of them so they go along with the agenda of militarism as opposed to peaceful contact with these civilizations. And it's not hard to do if you have a certain orientation, if you have a certain mindset based on fear, xenophobia, us versus them, that whole mindset. So that's really the criteria. Whether someone is pulled in the loop of this secrecy in government or not has to do with what their values are, what their psychological profile is, whether they will go along with the agenda of secrecy. If they will not go along with the agenda of secrecy, they're not going to tell you anything. I don't care if you are the President of the United States or the CIA Director or the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. But there have been people who do know in those same positions. Why? Because they were willing to go along with this chicanery. Now, if the next document you can put up, it's just a partial list of the sort of VIPs and government official I briefed. It goes 3 pages long. It's 50, 60, 70, and this is just a few of them. Every single one of these people, without exception, and you can scroll down through them, and just flip through. I'm not going to go through them all. We don't have time. This is a lot of work, having private meetings with this many people. Every single one of these people, from Senator Claiborne Pell to the CIA director to the head of intelligence for the Joint Chiefs of Staff to the head of the Defense Intelligence Agency, the biggest intelligence gathering entity in the Pentagon, every single one of these people wanted to know but had been denied access to these unacknowledged special access projects. Every single one of them. That is the proof we have. If we ever had to go to court to prove that the operation is illegal, and these people, the ones still living, would be subpoenaed. Because, believe me, and I have more, one of them that you see on page 2 here is Lord Hill Norton. And if you go to this next document, this is a 5-star admiral. How many people have heard of Lord Hill Norton? He's actually a great guy. He passed away not long ago. I don't mind sharing these couple letters. I have a whole file with him. He asked me to come to his estate in England and brief him back in, I believe it was 1990s sometime. And he was a 5-star admiral, what they used to call Sea Lord. And Lord Hill Norton, is that the one? Is that the right one? Yeah. He had found out through other sources that UFOs were real and that there was a big operation in the UK that was this transnational, deep national security state working with the British. But he was head of the Ministry of Defense, and as such was head of MI5 and MI6. He was also head of the Military Committee for NATO. He had no knowledge of these projects the entire time he was in government. And when I met with him at his cottage, and you know what's kind of cute about it, at the second document, if you go to the next one, he says, "I thoroughly enjoyed our talk when you came in August." This was in August of, I guess it was 1995. And I am grateful to you for your time. I read all the materials you left me, and I intend to read it all again. I also shared it with Countess Murray, who shares our interest. I have an idea you may have met her some time ago. I meet a lot of folks. I find your latest brief on the national security implications of the UFO subjects very clear and very convincing, and it goes on. It's a beautiful letter, and things he was going to do with the European Parliament and whatnot. He died not being able to accomplish as much as he wanted to with the British government because I had to explain to him why he never knew anything about this. And it's a very hard thing to sit with someone like a CIA director or someone like this, who's one of the most powerful people in the military and intelligence field in the world, and tell them, you just were not in the loop. And he basically said to me, well, why didn't they tell me? And he was a little hurt and kind of petulant. And I said, sir, I'm going to answer your question with a question. What would you have done if you'd found out there was a transnational entity, unacknowledged, running unconstitutionally in your country and mine, engaging in assassinations, keeping from the planet technologies that would save the Earth from environmental destruction and eliminate poverty within a generation. And that they are using these technologies to try to provoke, as agents provocateurs, an interstellar conflict and World War III. And that they were completely off the reservation without any controls from the chief executive or the legitimate governments of the world. And he hopped up and down. He's this little guy with piercing blue. He says, "I wouldn't have stood for a bloody minute." I said, "Well, that's why they didn't tell you." He says, "What do you mean?" He thought I was being impertinent. I said, "Because they knew you wouldn't go along with that agenda. Therefore, you're out of the loop." That's how it works. It's that simple. So you basically accumulate people who are enormously evil and who want to see terrible damage done to the planet because at their core, they love war and they love conflict. They do not want peace to break out. As one of them said to me, "Heaven forbid we should have peace on this planet. Too many people would be out of business. Too many of us would be out of business." Very cynical, but true. The next document is from one of my advisors to Admiral Tom Wilson. And it's about setting up a briefing for him. And I only put this up here because some people have challenged me, "Did you really have meetings with folks like this?" Yes, absolutely. And it was on my birthday in 1995, the first letter was written. I ended up meeting with him in 97 in April. But he helped us in a number of ways prior to that, as did this Admiral Kramer, who set up my meetings at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, the facility to which the crashed ET remains went in the 1940s in Dayton, Ohio. And this meeting was another one where I was able to provide to him some very important information prior to the meeting, including a 1991 document, which has not been declassified. And I will go to that one next. It's the National Reconnaissance Office document. And that document is basically a security alert. And the reason it's important is not so much for its content or on the next page, which is a warning that a group of UFO buffs were trying to penetrate the perimeter of Area 51, so it's called. Nobody calls it that, really. It's the Nellis Range. But this was generated, and you can see the date, July 1991. And take a note of the distribution list, please. And we're going to get back to that in a moment. But it's a security blue fire, which is a code name, 1991, Commander's Net, Royal Ops, Cosmic Ops. So Cosmic Clearance, you've heard of this? Not a myth, it's real. Mag Ops, Magi, that's the majority, it's the magic, M-A-J-I-C, Ops. And it goes through a whole bunch of them, Nellis Division, all these code numbers, and you get down to some really interesting things. MOC is Military Operating Center, and MOA is a Military Operating Area, and SOG is a Special Operations Team. But you get into Red Flag, Dart East, Dart South, Pahoot Mesa, Sally Corridor, Groom Lake, Dreamland, Blackjack Team. Blackjack Control is at the Edwards Complex in California. Roulette Team, Aquatech, Sea Spray, and others. Now, it's not clear to me who gave me this why they blacked out a couple of things. Maybe it was things that they were involved with personally. They didn't want to get fingered. But this secret document went to the Admiral prior to our meeting, and he actually recognized one of these entities, and he made an inquiry, and it was being run by a contractor. We're going to get to this next. And the contractor, one of these corporate contractors, When he called them up, he said, "I'm Admiral Tom Wilson." At that time, he was head of intelligence for the Joint Chiefs of Staff. "I want to be read into this project." Guess what happened? They said, "Sir, you don't have a need to know." Now, this is the guy who puts together the intelligence briefings for the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the United States. He was told, "You don't have a need to know." And Admiral Wilson said, "God damn it, if I don't have a need to know, who does?" They said, "Sir, we cannot discuss this with you further." They hung up and blocked his line. Now, this all happened before the stand-up meeting I did, where Edgar Mitchell, the sixth man to walk on the moon, and myself and my military advisor and a few other people met with the admiral in a stand-up, what's called a stand-up briefing. I was doing the presenting. That was supposed to be 45 minutes. It went for 2 or 3 hours. He kept canceling appointments downstream. This was at the Pentagon. And so I said, "Well, you know, sir, don't feel bad." And he looked at me. He said, "Well, who else is in this situation where this group is blocking access, who are in the national security apparatus?" I said, "Well, the president, the CIA director, etc." And I started naming them, and he was just, the fear in his eyes, the palpable fear and anger that something this important, that is real and legitimate, he knew it was, could escape the oversight of folks who have the security of the United States in their hands. So basically, they're trying to navigate without IFR. They're trying to navigate without radar through the dangers of the world, because the most important technologies and the most important information and the most critical national security secrets are completely off their, out of their scope, off their radar. And yet they're responsible for keeping America safe, and they're responsible for protecting us, and they're responsible for responding to threats. And so at the end of the meeting, I asked him, I said, "Well, Admiral, do you think you can help us?" And he just sat back in his head, this big chair, he sat back. He said, "Look," he says, "what I've learned from this meeting is that there is an illegal operation that has hundreds of billions of dollars, and over the years, trillions, that has technologies that can do circles around my B-2 stealth bomber, which is the best thing I know about. How am I going to take them on?" And I said, "Well, it can't be through a military engagement. It has to be through infiltration. It has to be through convincing them to come up." He says, "I don't know how to do that. They won't give me access. And moreover, I can't take any action unless the president authorizes it." And at that time, the president was Bill Clinton. And I said, "Well, no, he won't do that." He says, "Why?" He says, "Well, we briefed the president." And his best friend came to my home and said that if he did this, he would end up like Jack Kennedy. And I'm quoting. He says, "Well, there you are then. Point, set, match." And I said, "Well, you know, someone's got to do it." Invariably, these people say, "Well, you can do it." And I learned, if you look at, there's a movie my wife and I saw this past week called Bridge of Spies, and you realize there's this attorney named Donovan in it. It's a true story based on the Gary Powers U2 shoot down. And he was sort of the expendable guy. I'm the expendable guy. I'm the guy, it doesn't matter if they get killed. Because basically that's what Clinton's people told me. It doesn't matter if you get killed. We don't want the president to get killed. So, I mean, I know that's ugly, but it's the truth. So that's why I'm doing it. So this document, the reason it's so critical is that it actually has the action one. This is the first document on the top of the large briefing that President Obama got when he became president. And John Podesta, who was his guy who put together the Obama White House, was the man that we provided this for. Because Podesta has publicly come out, as you know, in favor of disclosure and ending secrecy. So basically, it was from me to Podesta to Obama. And of course, I mean, I didn't expect Obama to be able to do anything about it, because having these project code numbers and being president doesn't give you access control. You know the difference between knowledge of something and access control. You can know about something, but if they're non-responsive to your orders, like they were to this admiral, it doesn't matter if you're a general or the president or a CIA director, because they're basically going to say, buzz off, we have more power than you do, and go away. And that's how it operates. That is how it operates. This is naked, raw power. It's how it works. So this next document I want to share, unfortunately, did not come out. It's the Congressman Cox. As you know, he was SEC head secretary for W. Bush. But back when he was a congressman from Orange County, a good friend of mine who knew him set up a briefing between me and the congressman at his offices in Orange County. And he was on several key committees, Armed Services Committee, et cetera, and so on. And he wanted to know about the UFO issue. And I said, okay, well, I'll come in and I'll brief you. And he said, well, this has never been brought up at a briefing. I said, no, you wouldn't be, because I briefed members personally of the Senate Intelligence Committee and Foreign Relations Committee and House Government and Oversight Chairman and everyone you can think of personally, face-to-face. And in every case, they have been completely without access. And when they make an inquiry, they're told no such project exists. It doesn't exist. It's unacknowledged. Unacknowledged. Doesn't exist. And he says, well, I would like to know. He says, where the heck are these things going on? And who are the corporate entities? And where are the bases? So that was the genesis of the famous Cox memo, which, you know, became kind of infamous because I wrote it to him. And I basically did a subject of a brief summary of the people who I briefed who don't know and a course of action that he needs to take. Unfortunately, that document didn't come out. It got scrambled by the electronic gremlins in the computer, unless he's fixed it. No, he hasn't. So basically, I describe who is not able to do this, but where the places are. And that was the genesis of this, which is the facilities list. And I want to go through this very quickly of where the key facilities are. Now, keep in mind, these are all run by a hybridized entity. It's part government, unacknowledged special access project, compartmented, deep black, transnational security state, and three-quarters corporate. The action is in the corporate sector. But at each of these bases, there are contractors who run the operations. Do you understand how this works? In other words, the government doesn't do that much. The government does WFO, work for others. So they issue contracts. So you'll have Bechtel Corporation, or you'll have Lockheed Martin, or you'll have whatever. But the key facilities I want to go through, and there are others. This is a list that I've updated. I updated it for the president in 2009. A very chief one is Edwards Air Force Base. And there's a whole constellation there. Haystack Butte, China Lakes, George Air Force Base, they retired Norton Air Force Base, Tabletop Mountain Observatory, which is run ostensibly by NASA, and Blackjack Control. So I had a source at Blackjack Control associated with the Edwards-related facilities, but the Blackjack team you saw on that list was Nellis. So there's Blackjack Control and Blackjack Team. And then there are aerospace facilities, and these are all DUMs, deep underground military bases, or UGBs for short, underground bases. Northrop, the Ant Hill Tejon Ranch, McDonnell Douglas, the Llano plant, Lockheed Martin, Hellendale, the Phillips Labs, and the North Edwards facility. And I will add that since then, a newer facility called the Cube, which is up past Lancaster, Palmdale, up in the high desert outside of in the Edwards range and classified airspace, is a Lockheed Martin Skunk Works facility where the state-of-the-art R&D is going on. Keep in mind that Lockheed and Northrop have multiple generations since 1954 of what you would call a UFO, man-made UFO, that are, as the head of the Lockheed Skunk Works said to several people on my team, including Jan Harzan, the new head of MUFON, the Mutual UFO Network. He's an IBM executive that's retired. I've been friends with him since the 20s. I mean, since the 90s. He is a man who is of great integrity, and he actually was at the meeting, along with several other of my friends, when Ben Rich, the head of the Lockheed Skunk Works, a super secret, it's where the U-2 spy plane in that movie came from, said, "We can take E.T. home. We already have the technologies to take E.T. home," and ended his presentation with a slideshow of a black disc going out into space. Sounds fantastic. No, it's not. It's the head of the Lockheed Skunk Works. So we're flying around on jets, which are basically a vacuum tube that's pressurized with a bomb, a pre-positioned bomb called explosive jet fuel A that you're flying on, thousands of gallons of, when we have had these things since the 50s. How ridiculous. We're sending our astronauts up on rockets that blow up and kill them like the shuttle astronauts when we've had these things since the 50s. This is criminal. It's outrageous. But that's the way it is. So this is how it's developed. And then I just wanted to let you know that this new facility, the Cube, is, I have an engineer that I've met with who works in that facility. And they work on not just the propulsion systems, but also the electronic warfare systems and the bio-nanotechnology, which we'll get to after our break. And those are the things that the UFO retail world of books and movies and conferences would call aliens. These are man-made. They have integrated circuits in their brains, and they walk around. They're little gray or reptilian or creepy-looking things. These are man-made, 100%. And I know the men working on that, but the Cube is associated. That's one facility associated with those. Another facility is Dulce. Another one is Pine Gap. So the other, of course, you know, you've all heard Nellis Complex. It's Area 51. More specifically, it's S4, S9, and S12. Those are compartmented areas. You have to have a password and biometrics to get into them. Pahoot Mesa and Area 19, and Groom Lake. These are all things that have been provided to our government officials. In New Mexico, you have the Los Alamos National Laboratory. It has an underground connector, underground, that goes to the Dulce complex, which most people don't think can really exist, because you go to Dulce, there's nothing there. Remember what this simple fact. Nothing critical is above the surface of the ground. It's either in space or it's underground. Everything, including White House facilities and Pentagon. Everything critical is underground. And the Kirkland Air Force Base has the Sandia National Laboratories and the Defense Nuclear Agency, Phillips Labs, again, Manzano Mountain Weapons Storage Facility and underground complex that connects Coyote Mountain Test Site, north end of Manzano, the White Sands Complex, and again, the Dulce Complex. So Kirkland Air Force Base, and that's outside, of course, Albuquerque. I've been there. In Arizona, a key facility is Fort Huachuca. It's a underground base, most of it, that's critical. It's Army Intelligence Headquarters. There is a storage facility where a man, as of the 1970s, who was on my team, worked in it, and at that time, they had 9 extraterrestrial spacecraft that had been down using these electromagnetic pulse-scalar weapons, and a whole lot of different ET species that were frozen there. And that's at Fort Huachuca, ironically near Tombstone. The other ones that I just want to mention, Cheyenne Mountain, which is under the mountain in Colorado Springs, has a dedicated area for just the deep space network tracking of interstellars that are in our solar system. And one of my military advisors, a man who's been in many of these unacknowledged special access projects, actually was in that facility and got to see this Console 50, where they had tracked, and he said that they had tracked an object at that time that was in our solar system that was 26 miles in diameter, an artificial ET object, moving, as he put it, under its own steam. He's a Navy guy. I said, I don't think it's working with steam, but yeah, you're right. Another critical facility is the Lawrence Livermore Labs. the Pine Gap underground facility in Australia. I have a picture, actually, of the above ground facility there that a man who'd worked there sent to me. The Redstone Arsenal underground complex in Alabama, that's also has an association with the Marshall Space Flight Center. And in Utah, one of the most critical, and this is the most critical one that's new, is the Dugway Proving Grounds outside of Provo. And this is classified airspace above and no access by ground. Above ground, you don't see much, and everything is underground. Richard Foch, this Naval Research Labs official, was out there with some Generation 5 or 6 or whatever night scopes doing an operation, and he looked out and he saw these objects coming out from underground that then zipped over, and that were these massive disc and triangular shape anti-gravity objects that were hours, and some were just sitting out there watching him. And that's outside of Provo, out in the desert. So that is a very key, and that one is mostly manned by folks who are part of the Mormon corporate empire, which, if I were to rank who has what kind of say-so over policy on this, that would rank certainly ahead of the president or Congress. I won't comment further than that. This is not to make an aspersion to rank and file Mormons. It's just this is the, how that operation works. The agencies in the U.S. government are associated with this. The AFOSI, Air Force Office of Special Investigation, and of course, compartmented operations at CIA, the Defense Advanced Research Project Administration, the Defense Intelligence Agency. Now, notwithstanding, I briefed the general who was head of it. He wasn't given any information, but we have Disclosure Project witnesses who are DIA assigned contractors who had were very involved in ET and UFO technology issues. Certain compartmented operations at the FBI being tightly held, and every military intelligence division, Army, Air Force, Navy, have compartmented unacknowledged operations that feed into this magic committee. The National Reconnaissance Office, the National Security Agency, again, a very compartmented operation, certainly nothing that Edward Snowden had access to my knowledge, although it's been asked, and the various space commands. Private corporate entities include a BDM Corporation, Bechtel Corporation does most of the underground base construction. I know that the tunnel being built from Los Alamos over to Dulce. For years, people heard, you look and Google this, the Taos, T-A-O-S, hum. A lot of New Agers thought it was like Gaia singing or something. I'm going, no. There's a massive nuclear-powered tunneling device that was going from Los Alamos over to Dulce, and as it was going, it goes through bedrock and classifies it into this massive tunnel that then anti-gravity electromagnetic vehicles transport people carriers, underneath the ground. And as it was going through that bedrock, it caused this vibration. But that was being operated by Bechtel, and I was at a meeting with Stephen Bechtel once, and you know, they are very key into Booz Allen Hamilton, of course, is who Snowden worked for, but they're a key contractor. They do have a compartmented operation dealing with this. Boeing Aerospace, EG&G, very key facility for creating electronics and also the state-of-the-art nanotechnology implants that are put into abduction victims, people that think they had contact with ETs, but they're actually being abducted by military and corporate folks. E-Systems, which is now a division of Raytheon, Lockheed Martin, I've mentioned, McDonnell Douglas is now part of Boeing. MITRE Corporation, M-I-T-R-E, very key in terms of anti-gravity and high-tech. It's here in the D.C. area and other places. Northrop Grumman, I mentioned Phillips Labs before, Rockwell International, SAIC, and this is one of the crown jewels. SAIC is a company, Science Applications International Corporation. Admiral Bobby Ray Inman has for years been a member of this magic committee, along with Dick Cheney and Papa Bush, but the SAIC, he had been National Security Agency head. He moved from National Security head over to the board of SAIC. And in a little side story, interestingly, when I asked Senator Barry Goldwater, when I was at his home some years ago, and you know, he'd run for president in 64, but he always had an interest in this, but had never been told anything. And we started comparing notes of who we knew, and he said, how can I help you? I said, well, if you could reach out to some of these people on this magic committee, it'd be great. And so, you know, we named some names. He didn't know the ones I mentioned. And then I said, well, Admiral Bobby Ray Inman. He says, oh, Bobby Ray, we've been friends for years. I said, well, get hold of him. Give him a jingle, would you? So he did. Biggest mistake of his life. He got hold of me. He says, I can't make any more phone calls like that for you. He tore me apart. He tore me a new one. But Admiral Inman, definitely a magic member, as are other chief people on the SAIC. But it's compartmentalized. So, you know, most people work on conventional things there. A TRW, Village Supercomputing, Whack and Hut, security, does a lot of security for magic, and then there are others as well. So, you know, some of these are ones most, you know, most people have never heard a lot of these corporations. They're huge, and they have enormous reach. And I think that what you have to understand is that there is certainly not limited to that list, but it feeds into a system. And most people don't even understand how it works. And I always tell people, go back and look at the interview of Denise McKenzie. Worked for SAIC. She got a job there as a sort of clerical administrative person. She was in an office. It's kind of like the mafia. You know how the mafia will have like a pizza parlor or some little shop, and they'll come in and, you know, that's the storefront. But it's actually laundering money, and they're doing their drugs and pimps through the back door. That's how this works. So she was in this office at SAIC, and it was an office. It was, you know, running multi-million-dollar contracts for the U.S. government. And she said, "What is this? There's nothing going on here." And she went to this file cabinet, and there were just all these dummied-up reports that would go back to Capitol Hill to justify the money. And when she started asking about it, they said, don't ask about this. And what she basically was told, this office receives the money. We generate false reports back to the president and to Congress. That money then passes out of this office to a black project dealing with UFOs, electronics, anti-gravity, stuff like this. So when you get to some of the accounting, I met recently with a big one of the big four accounting firms. They said, yeah, this is exactly how it works. If you go to, they'll basically say, here's what we're doing. And if you try to penetrate further to actually get to a granular level of where the money is going, they'll say, well, you don't have a need to know. That's a top secret, special compartmented intelligence. And basically, you have to take their word for it. So it all gets rubber stamped by the big four auditing firms. But it's very illegal. You'll remember in the film Sirius, Donald Rumsfeld, the day before 9/11, I'm not sure he knew he was being filmed, said $2.3 trillion unaccounted for. Recently I found out from a good source, it's $8.5 trillion now. So there's $8.5 trillion that have basically been embezzled, misappropriated, used without the knowledge of the Congress or the president. That's a lot of money, even for America. So that is exactly how it operates. But if you take that one little example from SAIC and multiply it through all these corporations and all these different government offices, that's how the funding mechanism works. Does that make sense to folks? So I hope that made sense to you guys. I'm going to say let's take about a 15-minute break to stretch and to have a bathroom break. And when we come back, I'm going to go back into deep knowledge of how the funding works and really what the agenda is behind the secrecy. Thank you very much.
Okay, so that's part one of Dr. Stephen Greer's presentation. I hope you found it as interesting as I did. Lots of stuff to think about. Just his exposure of what's going on at secret levels in the government is worth a lot, and I would encourage you to really deeply consider some of what he's brought out. Now, I've already used up a lot of our time here, so I'm going to go quickly through some points that I wanted to share with you. Did you notice how he brought up the point that I think it was in this first half that the ridicule that people feel toward anybody that believes in UFOs, and it's immediately translated over to believing in little green men, which, you know, I'm not saying there's no little green men in the universe anywhere, but Walt Disney was used to make that ridiculous. And I thought Walt Disney was a really neat guy when I was 5 years old, and I enjoyed a lot of his movies, many of which I saw when they first came out a long time ago. But Walt Disney, according to Stephen Greer, and I believe him, has had strong CIA connections and was used to make sure nobody believed in the UFO information, just in case any of it got out. So we have some points to review here. The psychology, as I mentioned before the presentation, to continue the petrochemical industries, fuel, plastics, also coal, nuclear power, which is completely insane from any rational point of view. Nuclear power should be banned from the planet and should never have been started. All these specialized scientists that are trained not to know the context of what their expertise is in are used as tools to bring out and then maintain technologies that are absolutely suicidal for the planet. But everybody, and I think all of us, want to feel good, right? We want to be happy. We want to be high. We want to have as much high energy as we can. This is why some people fall for drugs, even though the drugs are going to end up destroying their bodies and brains. They just can't get enough of this high that they get that way. And there are other people, maybe they still use drugs too, they probably do, but they also get high from living in positions of power where they can feel like they can control everybody else and, you know, even kill everybody else. Obama is supposed to have made that quote that I'm very good at killing people. This is the kind of mentality that comes out that these people are living for. And of course, they'll kill any of us that get in the way of what gives them their high, their drug, which is power. So I'm not sure about the answer yet to that, but that's an answer we really need. And Dr. Greer, doesn't come up with, you know, just a really obvious answer. But he does say that if we're interacting with more intelligent civilizations, which I think it's overwhelmingly proven that we are, and they're not malevolent at all, because we would be gone by now. They're not doing anything bad. And even, I didn't even know before I heard this from Dr. Greer, but some of the things that are blamed on the malevolent, supposedly malevolent ETs, have actually been done by our own government. It's actually not a shocker if you're familiar with the kind of government that we've got at this point, or rather, who's in it. So he says, you know, put out the intention of asking these other more advanced civilizations for help. And I see nothing wrong with that at all, because good relations are necessary and beneficial. And to think that we're the only intelligent life, even to call us intelligent life, you know, based on what humanity has, you know, done at this point and how it's hanging on the verge of annihilation in so many ways, it's just really silly. I mean, the universe, and as far as I can tell, or the universe is, and the other dimensions of life, were not created at random. They didn't happen by chance. It wasn't just some atoms lined up. There is depth of amazing, you know, consciousness everywhere that is way beyond what we arrogantly think we know. So, however, we have the ability to learn as much more of it as we want to if we take the attitude of the real scientists, if there were any, and say, show me, I just want to know what's true. I don't care if it contradicts what I believe or what any group believes. I want to know what's really true. Because if you have a deep knowing inside yourself that the ultimate reality is based on complete love and consciousness, what could you possibly have to fear? There isn't anything. And fear always skews our judgment. So anyway, he says, ask these civilizations for help. But I'm saying, fine, that's great, but don't overlook the power that's hidden inside you, because the same source that, you know, created any kind of high intelligence, that's where we came from as well. And so, yeah, we have to work on the outside any way we can do things to help others, help the world survive impending catastrophes on every side. In other words, activism, positive activism, not rioting and burning down buildings or things that are really dumb like that, and not spreading division between people, which is exactly what our rulers want us to do. Spread unity and spread caring about everybody, no matter whether they agree with you or not. And this could bring harmony back to the planet. So the major focus, even if we are involved in all kinds of benevolent actions and the outside, our activism, the major focus needs to be internal. And that sounds like a contradiction, but the reason it's not is that the more clearly conscious we get, then the more powerful we are in terms of our potential healing effect on the world and on other people. And, you know, we had this guest that was super popular on our show for three different times, Barry Troer, right? And he was saying how powerful EMF radiation is. You remember? I think, you know, many of you remember that, or if you don't, it's a really valuable set of interviews you should go back in the archives and listen to. And many people are still saying, EMF, that's nothing. Wi-Fi, everybody has that. We walk through it every day. How could it possibly do anything to anybody? You can't even feel it. This is a mistake. The really subtle energies are the most powerful. And EMF was apparently designed to be very harmful, and it's doing its job. But it's not the only radiation type of energy, it and nuclear and things like that. We also are transmitters and receivers of very fine energy. And even people that have almost no awareness of this are suddenly aware, you know, without explanation, that maybe someone walks in the room or somebody is thinking about you and you turn around and see somebody staring at you. It's not scary and it's not evil. It's just things that we have to become more sensitive to become aware of, and we can use these things for good. And leaving everything in the hands of people who have malicious intent because we're scared to find out about new things is not really a brilliant plan. So I'm suggesting to start becoming aware of the incredible power that we have inside ourselves as transmitters and receivers. And it, you know, God, there's so much I want to say, we're almost out of time. But you know the reason why the golden rule exists? Is it just because you can say you're good if you do it? No, that doesn't really mean anything. It's because it's real. We are also deeply connected. There's this ancient law of nature I've mentioned before, predates any kind of philosophy or religion that we've ever heard of, and it was operating from the very beginning. And what it says is that whatever we do to or for others comes back to us multiplied. And this has been expressed in many different words. But it's absolutely true. It's absolutely powerful. If you really want to help the world, aside from your physical activism, start playing with this. Have good thoughts and good emotions and good intent and good wishes for everyone else around you, for the earth itself, for animals, for everybody. And you know what will happen instantaneously? It changes how you feel. It starts making you feel better, and it makes your mind clearer. And any kind of work that you feel is important to do, it'll make you better at it. And if you tune in as the this is the transmitter part, what you send to other people. But you're also a receiver, like a radio station that can tune the dial by your thought and intention. If you keep focused on things that are really bad and absorbing the energy from them, and I don't mean you shouldn't know about them. You have to learn about them so you can act in a good way. But don't absorb their energy. We're eating 24/7 on a very subtle level. Your food is critically important for your physical body and your health and your brain and all that. It's absolutely essential. But on a subtle level, we are eating 24 hours a day by what we leave our attention on in such a way that we're absorbing the feeling from it. So in other words, if you have to study some criminal activity, don't dwell on it in the way that you absorb negative feeling from it. Leave your intellectual ability to understand and strategically learn about things on any bad thing that you have to learn about. But at the same time, I'm giving you something incredibly valuable if you ever feel like trying it. Leave that eating, mental eating faculty, whatever you'd call it, on whatever's the most beautiful, inspiring thing to you, and never take it away. And this will utterly change not only you, but everybody around you. It's a way to make a super powerful contribution to the world. So anyway, go to the website, lostartsradio.com. Read the stuff we've got there. It's educational material, articles coming out pretty much once a week again now. Sign up for the free newsletter. I'm putting together another issue of that. If you want to keep us on the air, I'd really appreciate if you consider donating something, unless you're struggling to pay bills, in which case, please do not give us anything except your attention. But if you have money, donate, and we have a better chance to keep going there, because we're not getting paid to do this. Myself or Doug Diamond of Diamond Disc Audio, who holds this together, and we could use your help to keep this going. All the archives are accessible through the website, lostartsradio.com, and really deeply appreciate your being with us. Remember, next week is the conclusion of the presentation from Dr. Greer. Have a great week, and we'll see you next time.
Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/LostArtsRadio. Visit our website at lostartsradio.com for Richard's weekly focus articles, as well as lots of other really great free educational resources. We also have links to all of the great independent musicians whose music we feature each week on Lost Arts Radio. Please check out our new store page at richard.talknetwork.com. This is our new branded link for our store page on our new radio network, talknetwork.com. And if you like Lost Arts Radio, please consider donating a few bucks or leave us a tip to help keep us on the air. We spend many, many hours each week to bring you the best show we can with the best guests around. You can find our donate button on our website at lostartsradio.com.
Every day I've been waiting for the sunshine. It's been coming my way. And oh, it's been coming my way. I've been dancing at a hold down. Love to chew the fat with folk. I've been sipping on the moonshine. I've been telling dirty jokes. And oh, 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 it's been coming my way. Is it leaving, deceiving, relieving me anyway? I'm hard of hearing, believing, the healing, it happens every day. Out a postcard, I could tell you all the news. I've been fighting off the demons. There's no way that I can lose. And oh, 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 it's been coming my way.
coming my way. And oh, 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 it's been coming my way.